Everybody, thank you so much for joining us today for this webinar. This is a pretty cool format. I'm really excited about this because we are going to be speaking with Melteo, Exact Metal, and Desktop Metal. We have a variety of questions and we have kind of a cool format where we're going to be showing some parts. And what's really unique about this is that we get to hear direct feedback from experts at each of these companies. Who probably know more than anybody in terms of answering these questions. So this is going to be a really unique view into metal 3D printing and where it fits and where it's ideal. So I think everyone's going to learn a lot today. Just want to note that as we're going, yes, please do submit questions when they come up, but just know we'll address all of the attendee questions at the end of the webinar. So everyone here may or may not know SimQuest, but just wanted to take a couple quick minutes here and just give you a quick idea of who we are and where we fit into the world of advanced manufacturing. So we've actually been around since 1990. Actually, the name SimQuest, CIM, means computer integrated manufacturing. At that point, that was really sort of the main term for what we were doing. And it's funny because you don't actually hear it all that often anymore, but that's actually where the CIM comes from in SimQuest. But we've been doing 3D scanning, 3D printing, and MasterCam for quite a while. MasterCam is actually what we started with the company with, and we are one of the largest MasterCam dealers in the entire world. We're typically battling for one or two pretty frequently, but just a ton of expertise there. Everything that we do, pretty much, we can. We implement it. We offer various services and consulting. The bottom line is if you have a need related to any of our products or close to tangential to any of our products, there's probably a good chance that we can help you. And so we serve down from Maine down to South Carolina and over into Pennsylvania, Ohio. In terms of the technologies that we represent, no 3D printer can do everything. So we went out and we found the best possible partners we could for each major segment. And what we're going to be focusing on today is everything in that metal category. So I'm going to start here with some quick introductions. Actually, better yet, I'm going to ask the experts at each of these companies to give a quick introduction and just tell us a little bit about their company. And we're going to start with you, Juan Mario. Please go ahead.
Thanks, Jim. It's a pleasure to be here with you and the team. My name is Juan Mario Gomez. I'm the founder and CEO of Exact Metal. I'm just super excited to be here. We started Exact Metal with the idea that metal 3D printing, in particular powder bed fusion, metal 3D printing had lots of value in the marketplace, but that not many people had access to the technology, that the price points were just so expensive that the value being created by just being seen by a few companies and not the mainstream of the technology. So we launched the company, developed a product, pivoted a couple times, and now we're pretty excited where we are, not only in regards to the product, but also our partners like SimQuest. So we're just very excited to be partnered with you. My background, I'm an engineer by training. I worked at GE for over 27 years as an engineer and then an executive. And then left GE about 8 years ago and started Exact Metal. I've been here ever since, so that's a little bit about me.
Awesome, thank you so much. Mm-hmm. Mike Humphrey, please tell us a bit about yourself and Melteo.
Sure, thank you. First of all, thanks for hosting this event, and I look forward to participating in this. I do think it is a unique format, so it should be interesting for the audience as well. So first of all, my company, Melteo, is a pretty young company, about 3.5 years old, and we're based out of Spain, kind of the middle of nowhere Spain, between Madrid and the Mediterranean Sea, surrounded by olive trees. But we're basically a new kind of technique, a different type of 3D printing than maybe a lot of you are familiar with. We don't use powder metallurgy. We use commodity welding wire as our feedstock. And it's a DED, directed energy deposition technology. So it gives us some unique flexibility. What we have on the picture here is our M450, which is a standalone three-axis printer. But you can also take our deposition head and put it on the end of a robot for like an eight-axis situation, or put it inside a milling machine for a hybrid application. So it gives us a little kind of uniquenesses in that front. Me personally, I'm a mechanical engineer, did that for about 8-10 years in the aerospace business, then got into CAD/CAM in its infancy. I ran Siemens NX when it was called McAuto, for any of you old enough to remember that. And but then got involved in finite element analysis for a long time, and switched over to 3D printing about 8 years ago with Materialize. And then I worked for a Stratasys reseller and a binder jet company before joining Meltio about a year ago.
Awesome, Mike, thank you so much. All right, Jonah, you're up. I'd love to hear more about Desktop Metal and your position there. Thank you.
Yeah, great. So thanks again, guys, for hosting this. Our partnership with SimQuest is super strong, and anything we can do to help and help your customers be successful, love to participate in things like this. So I'm a mechanical engineer by degree. I've been a customer of 3D printing for past 30 years. I started my career as a mechanical engineer in CAD/CAM also. I worked for Unigraphics, when they were an EDS company, so this was way back in the 90s. And I've been using different types and technologies of 3D printing in my jobs ever since. And one thing that was frustrating was that 3D printing back in the 90s and early 2000s was just making looks like, feels like models. What customers demand of 3D printing now is the functional part. And so Desktop Metal was founded in 2015, really to bring 3D printing into the production space. No more looks like, feels like, but actually functions. Functional metal parts, and also scalable, so that it could produce not just onesies, twosies, but hundreds and thousands of parts. And so what you see on your screen there is the shop system, and that is the entry level binder jet system that we'll talk a little bit about later in the discussion.
Awesome. Thank you so much. All right, so the format, what we're going to be doing here is we're going to start with just a general question, and that's going to be posed to all three of you, and anybody can kind of jump in as they see fit, add on to what someone else is saying, or maybe adjust a different response. And then from there, we'll show a part. So the parts that we're going to show, these are not parts that the panelists are aware of. We just picked some general application parts. We'll give a little bit of data on what the part is, how it's used, and then we'll kind of just, get a quick analysis from the three different companies on if this is a fit or not, and some detail on how they think they can do that part. So I think let's go ahead and get started. So within about 3 minutes, could you please just provide an overview of the unique capabilities and advantages of your company's metal 3D printing technology in comparison to traditional manufacturing or more widespread manufacturing methods? So, feel free to jump in, guys.
Oops, maybe I can start. So, powder bed fusion is a great way to get metal parts directly from the printer. There's the fact that we have increasingly higher laser power allows us to melt the part directly and fuse to a level that you get extremely high densities. These densities then allow you to have immediately off the printer a part that's functional. You will then have to process the part like you would forge a part, or process a part that was printed from a forge or machine from a forging. The technology uses a small laser spot. So when we can print very high resolution parts that are printed with a spot size of 50 or 100 micron. But because we use a small laser spot, we are somewhat slower to print the part. And then the way we can counter that is by either adding more power so that we can move faster with a laser, or we add more lasers. But at some point, the parts are either too big or the volume is too big for us to really be competitive in competing to some of the other technologies that are with other panelists. But it's today the technology most used in metal 3D printing, particularly for when you have the need for high resolution, high part performance, and right off the printer.
Awesome. Thank you for that.
Mm-hmm. I could pipe in. From our perspective, some of the differences with that our technology enables is we're getting lower price per part because we're using low-cost commodity welding wire as our feedstock. We're creating parts much less expensive than traditional metal powder-based systems, and that is opening up new industries and also exposing traditional manufacturing process to new competition in the AM space. For example, you know, if you're dealing with like an Inconel or a tooling steel, you know, and your current process is to hog that part out with CNC and you're throwing away 70% of the material and it's slow to cut and tears up your tools, you can print a net near shape with our technology and then just do a finish pass to get to the final tolerances that you need for a fraction of the cost and time. So places that used to use hogging out parts with exotic materials can now look at AM. Casting replacement is a big part of our business because, again, we're a near net shape process. So if you have investment cast parts or sand cast parts, you know, we can reduce the lead times, you know, from months to days, and also save you time and money. So you know, it's opening up new opportunities in industries other than aerospace and medical devices, which have kind of been the dominant place for metal AM so far.
Hi, thanks for that. Joan, I just wanted to, please don't feel limited. I know we showed that picture of the shop, but with any of your responses, please feel free to put any metal under your purview.
Sure. No, and Jim, you've done a good job of assembling a great panel here of three very different metal printing technologies, but three very complementary technologies. So laser-based printing, you know, like Juan Mario was saying, is one of the most mature of the printing technologies. It's been developed over the past 25 years, and it's adopted by some of the biggest aerospace companies in the world. So laser-based you know, printing is kind of this foundation that we build on. When you like Michael was saying, you go to a larger pen size, which is your welding wire, and you can print faster. And you know, of course, your resolution is reduced with a larger pen size, but you're depositing a lot more material that way. And desktop metal has taken a different approach. We've gone to the sinter-based approach with metal binder jetting, and that's where we actually use a two-dimensional printing process to lay down ink or binder onto the surface of the powder, just like you would print a page, a high-resolution image, and you do that over and over. With a single pass of spreading the layer of powder and printing the image over and over and over. And so the advantage of a binder jetting process is that it's scalable to faster and faster, faster and faster printing process. But it's very different from what Melthio is using with a DED or what Exact Metal is printing with a laser. So we chose binder jetting because it was compatible with a lot of the traditional powders that are being used both in laser powder bed and in metal injection molding. But as Michael says, in all of these processes, you're printing a base part that might need to become, you might need to come back and finish machine in some way to get a even more precise for surface finish or tolerance to your dimension.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much for that. All right, gentlemen, so this is the first part. Believe it or not, this is door hinge for a vehicle. And clearly the people who made it had know a thing or two about design for additive, because I think we can all agree this doesn't look like a traditional part. But some quick specs for you. This is 14-4 stainless. The company needs to make about 10,000 of these a year. The part's about 3.5 inches or 88 millimeters wide. The most important tolerance on this is the hole location. It's not even that the part, the hole has to be exactly right. It's that that location of the hole has to be about plus or minus 3 thou or 0.075 millimeters. Of course, they are fine with a little bit of post-processing to make sure those holes are cleared out properly. What do you guys think about this part, and how does it fit with your technology or not?
Yona, you go ahead.
Yeah, so I'll start. So this is a great fit for metal binder jetting. You mentioned it's about 3 to 4 inches in size. That is really the sweet spot for metal binder jetting. Again, metal binder jetting uses a sintering process. So we print the metal, we basically glue the metal together, and then we put it through a furnace that consolidates it into a final, fully dense metal part. It really erases the history that it was ever metal powder to begin with, and you end up with a fully dense solid metal part. But that consolidation process, that shrinking, prevents you from going to really, really large parts that are, you know, 10 to 20 inches in size. But 3 to 4 inches, perfect sweet spot, up to 5, 6, 7, or 8 inches, no problem. In this case, the tolerances of 0.075 millimeters or 3 mils, that's very tight. That's tighter than the process would allow. So this part would be printed at very high rates at very high speeds, but then would be finished machined. So you'd put it onto a machine afterwards, you'd locate some datums, and you'd come in and you'd clean up the whole geometry after the printing process. It looks like this part was generatively designed. So a lot of the geometry that you see here, we would estimate is not critical geometry. So in other words, you wouldn't have to touch it with a machine. And the surfaces, the mounting surfaces, the holes and the planes are the critical geometry, but they're the really easy geometry to come in and machine. So this should be a quick one setup on a CNC mill after it's printed.
Maybe I can comment on that a little bit more. The reason I said you want to go ahead is typically when somebody comes to me and says how many I'm looking at this part, and the first question I'll ask them after just looking at the part is how many do you want to print? And right. The answer is 10,000. Well, I'd love to sell you 10,000 printers, but obviously that's not the case. So really that technology is more appropriate there. The part obviously could be printed in laser powder, but it just wouldn't make any sense to do it that way because you just couldn't keep up with the volume. Here you would spend time looking at the part, analyzing the part, doing a couple of test runs, I think, to kind of manage the shrinkage, to validate it, also working on a binder jet system. And then you would tune it, and then you're ready to go. And then it would support that type of volume with some post-processing, but laser powder would be too slow.
If I could pipe in, I concur with Jonah and Juan Mario. This seems like an ideal part for binder jetting. Of course, you'd need to post-process it. On our technology, I suspect and it'd be a two-step process like what you do with binder jet. First, you'd print it, and then you'd come back and machine it. The volumes are probably too high at 10,000 a year for it to make sense for the Meltio technology. Because with the binder jetting, even though the process, kind of may take you 3 to 5 days, print today, wash, sinter the next day. Once you get that going, you can print a whole bunch of these in a short period of time. So this is probably best the binder jet part, I agree.
Okay. All right, thanks for that, everybody. All right, now we're jumping back to a question. So with respect to your different technologies, how do you approach, in terms of the design for the machine and in terms of the capabilities that you're delivering, how do you approach accuracy and repeatability?
Maybe I'll just go first. We typically look at this problem more in terms of what spot size we're using for the machine, and that tells us what kind of feature resolution we can print, let alone the accuracy and the repeatability. So typically, a lot of people are saying, this is my part, can you print it? And then I start looking at the features. And if you're looking at something that's between 50 and 100 micron feature resolution, we start getting there, assuming that the spot size will overmelt a little bit. So if you look at 50, compared to a 50 micron spot size, it's better to look at 100 micron feature resolution. Same thing if you look at 100, you look at 150, 200 micron feature resolution. We can get that type of feature resolution there. Typically, what I then tell people is that we can meet any drawing that the tolerance that you have on any tolerance that you have in your drawing, pending that it's not a machine interface point. If you have a machine interface point, we're going to have more like ASCAS surfaces. So the wall is going to move a little bit within your normal tolerance of the drawing, unless you try to have a critical interface point where you're going to post process and machine. After that, we just work pretty hard and where's the part located, make sure that the part is located, appropriate point, then we can find it. So when the customer then picks up the part and wants to then post-process the part, they can find the part and ensure that it's both accurate and repeatable from the post-processing operation that they're going to do. We never really have much of an issue where the part not being repeatable or accurate once we take into consideration the discussion that I just had.
Great, thank you. Jonah, Mike, go ahead.
Go ahead, Mike.
For us, accuracy is different perspective than the other vendors because you got to remember we're dealing with a feedstock that has a nominal 1 millimeter diameter. So the XYZ gantry systems or the multi-axis systems in a mill or on the end of a robot, they have pretty good accuracy. But remember, the material itself is, fairly, in relative terms, a millimeter is large, right? So we're not really trying to get down, and our minimum feature size is like 2 millimeters, okay? So we're more of a little bit bigger parts. When you know that you have to have a tight tolerance, we just add a little overage and understand that the customer is going to come back and CNC or grind or whatever they need to do to post-process it. On the repeatability question, we've got really good repeatability. I mean, anytime you're running a new part, the first time you run it, you want to kind of watch it a little bit just to make sure you didn't mess anything up. But once you got it running once, it's repeatable and pretty much running a 24/7 lights out operation after that. You only need operators to, add a new old plate and remove the old one.
That's great. So at Desktop Metal, I mean, the sinter-based technology that I've been describing is a scaling process in which you print the part in what we call a green state, and then it shrinks during the sintering process up to 16-17% linearly. And so that's really where all of your tolerances are built in, is into that shrinkage. We print at a very, very high resolution. So at 16 micron pixel sizes, at a very kind of accurate image that you put onto the powder. But then that image, that green part, has to then shrink. And that's very repeatable. It turns out that that's a very predictable and repeatable process to shrink and consolidate the part. But you still end up with what Mario was talking about, which is, as cast type of tolerances. Now, this is typical of all manufacturing processes, right? All manufacturing processes are characterized by what we call process capability. It's not right to say, hey, can you keep this type of tolerance, or can you, if in order for my process to work, I need you to keep this type of tolerance. Every process has its own process capability or its ability to create repeatable geometry. And then you design your part around that process. So as an engineer, what you need in order to design a part is not the tightest tolerances. what you need is to have a repeatable and understood process that you can design around. And all of these processes are that, right? All of these processes, whether it's binder jetting or laser-based melting or direct energy deposition using a wire, they all have a process capability that engineers can design around. And then from that, you understand what type of post-processing you might need to do. You need to come in and machine certain surfaces that might be out of dimension if your dimensions are really tight, or whatever you might need to do. And so at Desktop Metal, the way we approach accuracy and repeatability is with this process capability approach, or confidence intervals, which we refer to as CP or CPK of the process. And so if you want to keep if you're looking to keep a very high confidence interval, in other words, you want a process that's within three sigma of your tolerance, then your dimensional tolerance needs to be with binder jetting around 3%. If you lower that confidence interval, you can lower that dimensional tolerance to 2% or 1%. But you're still on the order of like an as-cast type of process that is, sometimes in some cases it's very usable, and in other times requires some post-processing.
Got it. Really, really appreciate that comment on designing for the process. And of course, the way metal additive is coming in is naturally, all the other ways of making it a general thing are far higher in quantity than we currently are. So people come in and they already have a process capability in mind. And they say, hey, can you make your part to match this? Yeah. And so we're in this interesting position of like, well, maybe I can try, but it's sort of the wrong question to be asking in the first place. So, because we're smaller, we abide by that a bit. But
Joe, if I can add maybe to the conversation, I think a good way to look at it when you're looking at your part is trying to understand what kind of feature and process, like a resolution that you need, the volume that you're looking at. But clearly understanding also the restriction of the process that we have here on the discussion here. We not only have a spot laser spot size that's either 50 or 100 micron, and but we also have a powder size. And so we for flowability of the powder, that is to allow the powder to flow over the laser powder bed, we need the powder to flow. That flow, we've proven over many, many, many years that we need the powder to be between 15 to 45 micron, 50 micron in grain sizes, in powder size. Mm-hmm. And that allows us to have very nice feature resolution. But when somebody says, I want a feature resolution that's below 50 micron, we start being limited by the powder or the pixel size, I could like to call it, in terms of it's no longer the laser that's limiting, it's the powder that's the limiting issue. When you look at technology with Michael, he can go very, very fast and build very fast, and that's great for great big parts or bigger volumes, and I'm sure we'll see some example seconds. When you look at Yona, he has technology that his powder is 5 to 15, I think, Yona, right? Something in that range. So he can get very, very small feature resolution, but then he has to there's all this iteration process that he has to go through, but he can get very nice looking parts that are very small, but you need to invest a lot of time to get the parts to work. Sure. So there's that trade-off is very important when somebody comes to talk to us or to any of us at a trade show, at a meeting, or just you doing your due diligence with Simquest. Understanding that is very important because it allows you to be a better decision maker in what you're trying to do.
And Jonah, perhaps maybe you might want to touch on live sinter here. I'll leave that up to you.
Yeah. So it's a great point. So what Juan Mario and what Michael were talking about in the is this iterative process that we go through in order to tune in a part for the process. And it's actually this is not unusual for any manufacturing process. You can think of it like you would make any metal part if you were making a tool to bend or to punch sheet metal. You would often need to run some analysis on how the parts bend. Do you have to, if you want to make a 90 degree angle, do you have to bend it to 90, to 91 or 92 degrees so that it springs back to 90 exactly? These are all simulations and considerations that that manufacturing engineers go through as they design a tool or manufacturing process around your part design. The same thing with castings, right? If you design a mold for a casting and you pour cast aluminum in it, that aluminum is going to shrink and it's going to pull itself away from the edges of the mold. It's going to twist and deform in certain ways. And those ways are, you know, somewhat predictable. And that if you do the analysis up front, you can predict exactly how the part is going to mold or cast. And the same thing is true for additive manufacturing. You can analyze the geometry and the way that that geometry is going to be printed. And then you can go through simulations ahead of time to so that your part is more accurate when it comes out of the printer. In binder jetting, that is a shrinkage that you can simulate, this shrinkage that I was describing of 15 to 16% linearly. You can predict how gravity is going to affect it and friction is going to affect it. And the same is true for laser-based and for DED as the part moves around while it's being printed. And so what we've done at Desktop Metals, we've built software around prediction and analyzing the geometry deformation or the printing process that you can run ahead of time. We call that live sinter. So if you wanted to print a part on through a sinter-based technology, you can run it through the live sinter software ahead of time. It'll tell you exactly how that part is going to move around, and then it'll generate an offset of that geometry that you then would print, and that printed offset would then move around and shrink into the exact part that you want out of CAD. It's just another tool that you can use to give yourself a better chance of success right out of the gate. It's kind of like a mold flow analysis tool that you'd use for injection molding or for casting.
Excellent point. All right, gentlemen, we're going to quickly move on to the next part analysis example. All right, so what you see here is an impeller. The material is titanium. It's roughly 6-inch diameter or 5-inch diameter or 127 millimeters. Of course, it was originally done by casting. The areas of flow are probably the most, and also where it would interface with the housing are definitely the most important, and that's where it would need to be machined. The quantity of this is about 15 or 20 pieces a month. So with that, I'll open it up.
The material is titanium?
I'm sorry?
The material is titanium?
That's correct.
Yeah, I mean this could fit in our machine. It's rather large, it would take some time to print. We would counter that by adding more lasers if time is super critical on the print. The surfaces are pretty vertical, so it wouldn't be much of an issue to print this in powder bed. It is titanium. Is a reactive metal, so if this is for hobby, I would not recommend it in powder bed because of the complications of titanium if the person's trying to buy a printer to install. But if this then definitely be printed in a laser powder bed.
Okay, great, thank you.
I think this is a good example of kind of an ideal part for our process. Because the size fits in our smallest machine. Of course, you could put it in a bigger machine too and make multiples of it. Volume fits nicely. And titanium's not a problem. It looks like we'd print a net near shape, and then a subsequent step would be to CNC machine the fins, if you will, and the hub. Maybe hone that so that you've got a nice good cylindrical fit there, and just kind of guessing at the size of that looks like we could pump them out in like 4 hours, something like that. And I don't know the weight, but it's like a less than $20 part to me with our process in a few hours.
Excellent.
Yeah. Depending on the tolerances that are required on those inner surfaces that look like they're untouched by a machine, if those tolerances are loose, then this is a great part to DED. You could go and crank these things out and then put them through a really simple turning process to machine them down to get them nice and tight. This is ideal geometry to to really crank out through binder jetting, metal binder jetting. But it is the titanium powder that is the complication here. Titanium powder usually requires an inerted system. Now in DED, you're using wire, so that's not an issue. Titanium is not dangerous, but in a laser-based process or in a binder jetting process, you're using fine powder to get your fine resolution and really nice surface finish. And that can be an issue if your system is not inerted. So right now, Desktop Metal offers a studio system in which we encapsulate that powder in a polymer. And that is okay. You could absolutely do these parts in a studio system where you would print the part in an encapsulated polymer and then come back and finish machine them. That's no issue. But I think that it would be faster to print these parts in a DED process.
I would agree that. I would agree even more if you had said the part was bigger. Let's say the part was, to me, around 300, 500 millimeters is the line between powder bed and DED. And then we can argue on feature resolution, but around some size like that, then there is a line. And we just are, the lasers are just not enough of them to be able to keep up with the speed of the DED. But if this part was smaller and this part had more feature performance, then I would select the laser powder bed. But looking at this part and even saying it's a little bit larger, DED would be the way to go to that. And I do like, when you have you just want to print one or two and the parts are rather vertical, DED is a great solution pending that the parts are large and then you finish it up like you would do in a traditional building operation, casting operation.
Great.
So I do want to comment a little bit about density. I think the density is something that's sometimes not talked about, and it's very important to understand. Here, when we print is using laser powder or using DED technology, we get very high densities, and that's very important because we get the part density immediately right after. If this part, for example, probably be stressed in a high demanding application. This part would need to be stressed. Now, if we went and said yes, we want to print this impeller, but we want 10,000 of them, and then you end up having the issue that we talked about earlier, and then you need speed. Then you start looking at a binder or a binder process or a sintering process where you need to get the volume to get what you're trying to do, but you don't sacrifice it by part integrity by just adding volume. And this is typically done in automotive forever, or even consumer goods, where they need the volume, so they add material to get the material properties that they need to get the part functional. And that's a very important also a very important point to think about when you're looking at your application. What kind of material properties do you need? What kind of volume do you need? And that's going to dictate by definition what applications, what technology is the right solution for your application. If you're looking to get, you want 99% density, but you need 10 million of them, it's not going to happen very well. You need to look at a binder solution to say, I need a lot of volume, and add material to sacrifice that volume. But if you start saying I want part performance and I have a few, then the direct energy deposition or the laser powder bed solution may be more attractive.
Yeah, thanks. I appreciate that perspective, especially with that trade-off between high density and being able to really optimize the size of the part, and then but needing to go higher volume and maybe adding a factor of safety, adding a bit of material, so that now you're confident using a process that maybe has a bit lower density. So excellent point there. We're going to go on to the next question here. What's the current list of materials, and which one set you apart or you're most excited about? So I guess to even phrase this a little bit different, I guess which materials do you think are most ideal for your process and really highlight the benefits of your process the most, and which ones are you seeing the most use in the field around?
So in laser powder bed, we need two things for the material to be usable. First, we need it to be available. In powder form, and in powder form of size of 15 to 45 micron particle size. And after that, we need it the metal to be fusible with the laser power that we have. Increasingly, us and other competitors that we have been introducing more and more power, laser power, to be able to fuse either faster or fuse more materials. But typically those are the two requirements that you have, is can I find it in powder form, and can I find it in can I melt it with the laser powder that I have? With that kind of set in mind, typically we do a lot of stainless steels, 360 nail, 17-4, 300 series, 55. We do tool steels. We typically have a material that's developing for the AM industry to satisfy the tooling world, which is margin tool steel, that allows you to replace a lot of high carbon content materials out there. There's also, not with us, but others, you can do H13, though H13 is very difficult to print, and it carries some more complications, but there are some people that do that. Then we do aluminum, titanium, Inconel-based 718, 625. Those are the type of materials that are typically printed with laser powder bit. We are about to announce a new material that we're quite excited about. We've been partnering with Uddeholm, and we're launching a corrosion-resistant tool steel. And we're excited about that because the margin tool steel is printable, but if it gets wet, it gets corroded. And so this allows us to kind of still get the performance that you would get on for tool steel with margin tool steel, but it doesn't corrode. Typically for us, if you also high carbon content is a problem for laser powder bit. High carbon content is kind of like the kryptonite of the laser. And so if you see yourself with high carbon content on the metal, typically it's not going to be a printable with laser powder bit. There's a lot of attention today in copper, a lot of with electromobility as well as rocket industry. Copper is very, very interested. And we do a couple alloys today. We do cobalt, copper, chromium, zirconium, and then we are about to launch also GR COP, which is a copper developed alloy developed by NASA for rockets. We in our current system architecture we cannot do pure copper, but there are some people that do pure copper. Just you need a lot more laser power that we currently have at the machine cost, price, performance that we offer. I think that's a short summary. Sorry, it took a couple seconds.
No, that was helpful. Thank you.
From a Melteo perspective, similar to what Juan Mario said, you know, the constraint is, can you get the material you need in a welding wire format? And since welding's so mature out there, you know, we can find just about any steel you can find in welding format, we can print. We have an open material strategy. So what we've done is we've identified kind of the most common types of materials, many of which Juan Mario has already presented, the stainlesses, the tooling steels, the nickel-based alloys, the titaniums, the brasses. Those are all certified materials from Melteo, where we've gone through and created all the print parameters for them, and we share the print parameters freely. You know, there's no charging for that or silly stuff. And people can buy the material from Melteo, or they can buy it, you know, from their local welding store. Heck, you can buy it on Amazon nowadays. And, you know, as long as it's the right diameter, you can use our print parameters and run. And what we've been doing lately is kind of not really just saying, hey, this is the print parameter for H11, for example, but rather here's a range of print parameters. And on one side of the range, you say, hey, this is the, if you want maximum density, which by the way, equals best surface finish, use these. If you want maximum speed, use this one. So, and we can adjust the kind of aspect ratio of the weld bead to make it tall and skinny or fat and short. And that gives us different characteristics. We've got a really controlled process, so we can play with those different things. Our current technology does not enable pure copper or aluminum alloys. But give us another 6 months and you'll probably see that those materials becoming certified on ours. We also have a handful of customers, and this really surprised me, in the jewelry business, some very prestigious names, and you know, that are using our technology with precious metals, gold and platinum, to make small parts, which doesn't seem intuitive for the DED process, but because of the lack of waste in our process, sense for them.
That's a very, very interesting point about a new fit based on that, about the lack of waste. So thanks for adding that. I'm sorry, Joe, trying to go ahead, please.
Yeah. No, so like, you know, like the other two technologies here, Desktop Metal has leveraged existing supply chains of metal materials, and in this case, metal powders. These are, you know, we've looked at using metal powders for the metal injection molding community, which are, you know, metal injection molding is, you know, 50, 60 years mature, and it makes, you know, very, very high quality materials and metals of a lot of different alloys. And so we've leveraged those existing supply chains, you know, just like Exact Metal and Meltio are doing, to bring that into our printing process in an easy way. And the list of metals is very long, but I can tell you that so binder jetting is a sinter-based process, like I mentioned before, and so it's very well suited for powders that don't weld well. Or metals that don't weld well, because we're not melting the powder, we're not melting the metal, we're sintering it. And sintering has a very different physics than melting. And so powders that that don't melt well or that require sintering to join are very well suited for binder jetting. And some examples of those are, you know, our stainless steels and super alloys, but also industrial ceramics. So industrial ceramics like silicon carbides are they're just impossible to really to melt and build up the way that you know, the way that Exact Metal and that Meltio are doing things. These ceramics just don't function the same way. So binder jetting is very well suited for those types of ceramics. Now you ask, like, what is, you know, what are some of the more kind of exciting metals that are coming? You know, we're bringing titaniums and aluminum into binder jetting. They're not available yet, but we're working on bringing reactive materials like those into binder jetting. But I tell you, the most excited that I get about the materials that we print are the core materials, the 17-4 stainless steels and the Inconels. These work really, really well in binder jetting. They produce amazing parts with amazing properties, and they're very, very high runners. So we're not really looking at the kind of the niche-y applications. We're saying, okay, where do you want to print the most highest volumes? Where do you need the kind of the highest properties of a corrosion-resistant, strong stainless steel? And those work really, really well in binder jetting.
Yeah, thanks for that. I'm glad you – oh, Mike, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
If I could. I neglected to point out one of the features that we have that is somewhat unique is that we can actually run parts with more than one material. So, you know, we can optimize a part where you do the infill in a very, you know, $8 a kilogram mild steel, but put stainless or something on the outside of the part for corrosion resistance. So that's a unique capability of the DED technology, and we're excited about that. But with Jonah, that, you know, our bread and butter is the stainless and Inconels and tooling steel. We wish we'd get more interest in titanium, but, you know, that's kind of unique to medical devices and aerospace, and you know, we're still trying to get certified our process to be, you know, ready for flight, so we're not, you know, selling end use parts in the aerospace business right now.
Thank you. Yeah, I just wanted to say I found it really interesting on the metal side that when I have conversations with people, it basically becomes, can stainless steel work for you? Because if it can, life's pretty great. Just the way on filament processes, ABS or PLA, just sort of settled, really, you know, everyone goes ahead and does that on SLS or, you know, sintered polymer. Nylon's an extremely popular material, so very, very similar. And Jonah, again, thank you for bringing up ceramic, because that is extremely notable that your process is useful there. All right, we will jump now into the next part. So this is a copper heat sink. It's roughly 2 inches or 50 millimeters wide. Those rods are about 20 thou or half a millimeter in diameter. Accuracy is not extraordinarily important. They need batches of about 10 of these per week, but here's the thing, is it can change a little bit. You know, maybe it's 2.5 inches this week, maybe it's 3 inches this week, because they have a product portfolio where they need slightly different sizes of this in different batches. So roughly 10 of those per week. And the other interesting thing is they are open to redesign of this part so long as it has the same heatsink performance or a little bit better, and as long as the price is the same or better. So with that, I will open it up.
This part is great for powder bed in terms of the volumes and the part variability that you're talking about. It would be, if it really well, it would be a part that would be very comfortable for the printer and the technology to operate with. The part resolution, the feature resolution, the spacing between the parts fits really well into powder bed.
Great. Mike, what do you think?
Not a good part for us. The resolution is much too fine for our process. And I think you said copper. We don't do pure copper right now. We just do, you know, copper alloys. And so this would not be a good fit for us. I could see it working for either the powder bed or maybe the binder jetting. But depending on volumes, it's probably better for the powder bed at the volume you specified.
Thank you. And don't worry, we've got a good one coming up for you. So
that's okay. Maybe not that, impeller, that impeller was good for us.
Yeah, fair enough. Fair enough.
Yeah, so this the geometry here is great for a binder jetting approach like Desktop Metal has. However, the copper adds a layer of complexity. Copper requires certain things that are a little bit more complicated than a stainless steel does, and so I would say that this is a perfect part for an exact metal type of laser powder bed fusion or melting process. You get the resolution that you need. You'll get this part as printed, so I think this would be a perfect part for laser powder bed.
I did think this would also be interesting on the studio system. I'm not sure if we're starting to push the limits on the size of those rods or not, but I've always thought it's a cool note that the studio can do pure copper.
The studio. I would say that the resolution of the studio system, this is these pins being half a millimeter in diameter, right. It would push the limits of that. It'd be interesting to print this part and see what you get out of it. I think pushing this into a binder jet printer that was set up to print copper, totally doable. I think this part would print really well on a copper binder jet machine. But again, the shop system is not set up to print copper. So you'd have to take it up into a P1 that would print this part. But I think a P1 would print this part beautifully. I do think though, at the volumes you're talking about, maybe a few per week, that doing on the laser powder bed would be just fine.
Perfect. Appreciate that. Thank you. All right. We'll jump to the next question here. What are the key trends and emerging technologies that you see shaping the metal additive manufacturing industry in the next 5 years? What's going on now that's going to drive the growth that we all really want to see? What do you guys think is coming down the road?
Speed. Manufacture metal. I'm not talking about all additive manufacturing now. I'm just talking about metal additive manufacturing. And you see all three of us pushing speed. We need the technology to be affordable. We need the technology to have more materials. We need to do more. But in general, people are even if you're printing one part, you're printing a million parts. A million is maybe too much. 10,000 parts. You want speed. And so you see in laser powder bed, you see us introducing more laser power. But we started the company with 100 watts of laser, one laser. And the machine that we had at the time was quite slow. Now we have a machine that goes two lasers, 400 watts. Some of our competitors have 26 lasers now, just announced in China. And so you see us introducing laser power and to get purely mostly speed, also some more flexibility in metals. But then you see us adding more lasers just to be able to get speed. And speed is productivity or print, being able to print parts faster is just opening up the application space more and more for metal 3D printing in general, either with laser powder bay, with DV, or with the sintering processes that Jonah offers. So speed is what I see dictating the future to sustain the demand that people want faster parts. And you just need it. You need it to be able to do what people want to do in metal.
Thank you.
Yeah, I would concur that speed is a critical component, but I would add to that cost. You know, because I think today, and maybe my colleagues disagree to a certain extent, but you know, the big success stories in metal AM are primarily in aerospace and medical devices in general. I know there's exceptions, but you know, but the cost is now getting lower. Not only the capital equipment costs, which I think all of us on this panel have systems less than 200K capex, but you know, the operating costs. What we find with the really low cost wire is that that's you know, introducing us into different area application areas that didn't even consider AM in the past. So I think cost is going to drive a broader adoption of the technology over more industries. Another trend that I think is happening is larger parts. You know, we're starting, and you see that on the polymer side too. You know, they're making huge parts, and we're not a wire arc vendor, but you know, guys are building bridges and things like that, using fatter welding wire, of course. But you know, so we're building parts that are pretty significant in size that are now making, you know, a sense for you know, a variety of different applications, and that'll just increase. And but part of that is the enablement of software, because when you stick a DED head on the end of a robot or within a five-axis mill, you have to have new slicing algorithms, not just the plain old XYZ slicing. You need to have slicing algorithms that can go around a bend and orbital slicing, you know, so that we use the additional axes to eliminate the need for supports. You know, if you have an overhang part like this, what you do is you just turn the part and then you no longer have an overhang, you know, so you know, those, that software enablement is part of it, and that's starting to happen. You know, certainly in the three-axis world, it's there. And on the five-axis, you know, standard CAD/CAM tools like MasterCAM or NX or Fusion 360, you know, they have add-in modules now for additive. But the horizon that's still kind of challenging is on the robot side of things, because dealing with eight different axes can get kind of confusing and takes a pretty high level expertise, and we need to make that simpler to get adoption.
Gotcha. Okay, so yeah, we're driving lower cost, and we're driving basically a simpler overall process to make adoption easier. So in the next few years here, Jonah, go ahead, please.
Yeah. No, I agree with both of these comments. You know, I think that, you know, generally speaking, additive manufacturing is relatively new. It's relatively young in its history. Even though it's decades old, it's still evolving. And one of the key drivers or motivators for new customers to adopt and invest in additive manufacturing is this idea of controlling their own destiny right now. They want to bring manufacturing in-house, and additive manufacturing, it's a path that enables them to do that, to control their own destiny by bringing manufacturing in-house. So metal additive is no different. And I think that it's going to follow the same type of trends that that polymer additive has followed over the past 20 years. And I think polymer additive has hit a ceiling in which the parts are, you know, our parts are great and they're being produced, you know, quickly, but they're hitting this limit in their functionality. They're not strong enough, or they're not high temperature enough, or they're not durable enough. You know, even when you bury carbon fiber in them, they're just not metal. And so metal additive offers this next level of manufacturing, whether you're doing prototyping or tools and jigs or something low volume production. And then especially if you want to get into high volume production. So I think one of the key trends that we're seeing in the industry is customers wanting to bring manufacturing in-house, manufacturing of functional materials and functional parts. So that's metals, that's metal manufacturing. And so we need to be, as an industry, we need to offer the right materials. And then we need to offer the speed. We need to be able to print the parts fast enough, so if they begin to gain traction, that the customers don't have to pivot their manufacturing process. You don't want someone to have to start with one manufacturing process and then switch to another. Mm-hmm. We want you to print one part or 100,000 parts with that same process. And additive represents something that can do that. So if you're printing the right materials at the right speeds, then your cost comes down. And that's ultimately how you begin to offset and compete with traditional manufacturing. So I think over the next 5 years, we're going to see core materials being printed very fast and very efficiently, designs being evolved for each of these manufacturing processes, and then we're going to see speeds and volumes increase.
Awesome.
Just wanted to throw in one more comment, if I could, mm-hmm. Jim. I was talking to some cats at this show in South Tech, and they were running Stratasys polymer machines. And we got to talking, and they showed me some of their parts that are made out of Ultim or Peak. And we got into it a little bit, and we realized you could build those parts out of stainless steel on our system for less than the high strength polymers. And they're stronger and they're metallic, more durable. So that kind of shook me up a little bit and made me realize that, you know, there's some polymer stuff going on right now that could get displaced with metal, you know, because the high cost of the polymers.
Yeah, that's a really interesting point. And that could be that, I don't know if I would, the polymer side is more mature, but it's certainly more widely accepted because there's lower barriers to entry, not only in cost, but in just general, you know, maybe mm-hmm. risk. It's pretty easy to go ahead and adopt a filament printer. And so they've advanced to a certain point where they're doing these high performance polymers. It's an interesting point that, you know what, and not just go to metal, it might actually even be more advantageous. So yeah, no, I like the comments. So we got speed as a major driver. That makes a lot of sense. We've got naturally, you know, lower prices as we start to hit higher volumes and focus on these core materials, better software. And I also really like the point that sort of controlling your own destiny. So, and the interesting thing about that is that's a hard value to calculate, but just to bring in a machine because you know that, you know what, when I'm down, if I need this pulley, this bracket, this sprocket, whatever it is, and I'm not going to be able to get it anywhere else, I can just go ahead and make it. And maybe it costs me a little bit more money, but I have it. I also think that's right, because that'll start to get people started with it. And, you know, ultimately that will scale to other applications. So excellent point there. All right. Focusing on this part now. So this is a fairly large drill bit, 150 millimeters or 6 inches on all sides. They only need about 4 to 6 of these a month. The material is a little bit flexible, except that shape at the end there, that typically was a carbide tipped bit. So it doesn't have to be carbide, but at least that very end of this bit needs to be extremely hard. So with that, I'll open it up.
Michael, go ahead.
Yeah, that looks like a perfect part for us. You know, and what we, I assume that this is in a corrosive, like sulfuric acid type of environment. So you'd want to have like a stainless, or heck, maybe even an Inconel if it's oil and gas business, for the body of it. And then we'd use like a hard material like a A2 or H11, H13. We've played around with tungsten carbide. We really haven't had a lot of success, to be honest with you. So if the application could live with the Rockwell C of like 53 or whatever H11 is, we could make those. Otherwise, you'd have to make the part without those cutting edges and insert them separately if they needed carbide. But the volumes are right, the shape is perfect, and that's pretty much an ideal part for us.
So if somebody wanted to save cost on this, is this maybe a candidate for multi-material?
Yeah. I mean, today we can only do two materials. So if you had a requirement and a hardness requirement, maybe you'd have to do stainless steel plus H11. Mm. In the future, if we have, say, a four material machine coming, you know, you could have the interior infill being a cheap 8 kilogram, $8 per kilogram mild steel in the infill, Inconel on the outside, except where the cutting bits are, and then a really hard tool steel for the cutting bits.
Awesome. Thanks for that.
Maybe I can add a couple of things. Sure. I think, Michael, this is definitely for a melt-to-tip type DED system. Perfect. And I think you can build the part very quickly, very fast, very cost efficiently. This is a little bit when the design for additive starts kicking in, and you start saying to yourself, okay, well, what if I had conformal cooling channels in here? What if I wanted to actually make the surfaces more near net shape? What if I wanted to have higher performance in some of the geometries? At this volume of size of 100, I think you said around 150 millimeters, it's not that big. So if you start saying, I want to push the performance of the part, you start saying, well, maybe laser powder bed could do the job. This part geometry, no, I think that this would be okay, unless you had a larger laser powder bed system, and then that could do the job pretty well. My point here is that this balance between part integrity, part geometry, part performance that you're trying to get, and that dictates what solution you should pick up. And the processes that all three of us are talking about allow you to not only take your state or your current state, but also start pushing yourself to, well, what if I change this differently? Now I can do things that are not traditionally dictated by my manufacturing process. This part was obviously before either casted or machined. Then, what if you had one more performance out of the part? So there's other things that can be done here. As is, I would agree. I would agree more if the part was larger. If you said the part, I like that rule of thumb, 300, 500 millimeters. Absolutely, please go DD. You're going to build a part so fast. It's going to be so very good density, very high performance into a part. Once you start getting this range below 300, you start arguing, do I need the speed or need the resolution? And then that our technologies would, you start getting really small, then you start arguing which one is different. And it's just it's pure math, really. It's not us versus them. It's just a solution for each customer.
Thanks, Juan Mario.
And Juan Mario makes a very important point. I mean, this, as you go bigger and bigger and bigger, the DED process gets much more and more attractive. The way that you're laying down material so quickly, if this part grew to, 500, 600, millimeters, DED is the way to make this part. 6 inches, this is still within the field of sizes that fit into the binder jet process, fit into laser melting as well. And I'd say that this part is actually a really good candidate for binder jetting at that size. It's the right size, and for high volumes of making this part, you could produce this part out of a tough or out of a hard stainless steel or high carbon steel. It could be it could be made out of a single part the way that it's shown in the picture. However, this is obviously a part that had carbide inserts at one point brazed into it. And that's really interesting because if you removed those carbide inserts and printed the part out of a tough stainless steel, and then brazed in those inserts the way that that Michael was describing, you could end up with a very similar part to what you started with. And in fact, the shrinkage process that happens during binder jetting, where you print the part basically with glued together powder, and then you put it through a furnace that shrinks the part into a fully consolidated metal, that can be used to trap these types of carbide inserts. These carbides melt at a much higher temperature than the stainless steel. And so if there was a little bit of design intent put into this, you know, if the part was redesigned with pockets that you can slip carbides into in the green state and then sinter them, the part would then grab a hold of those carbide inserts and hold them in place. And so that's, you know, the way that I would approach this part is if you really wanted to make it into a two-part with a tough metal and a hard carbide, that you know, I think binder jetting would be a great solution.
Yeah, that's a very interesting approach. It's a very creative approach. And like you pointed out before, like no manufacturing process stands on its own. So if you start to think about, you know, combining steps like you do traditionally anyway, it really opens up new possibilities. So very, very cool there. Moving on to the next main question we have, and then after that, we're going to open it up to the customer questions. So we don't have a ton of time on this, but just if you guys can just kind of give a quick example of a notable real-world application or success story where technology has made a significant impact. So yeah, if you guys can just pick an example where, you know, this was such a great fit for us and we're really starting to drive this industry forward with what we're doing. It's some story like that, that would be fantastic.
Yeah, but I'll start. And I'm going to kind of build up with what Michael said in regards to price or the cost of the technologies. Not only are we looking for speed, but we're also looking at cost. The lower the technology adoption is, then the more people are going to be able to buy it. And the more adoption there will be. For me, we launched Exact Metal, like I said at the very beginning, to make the technology affordable. So these high-value products that are being offered in the aerospace and the medical industry are available to more and more people. One, and then two, we want to see the technology decentralized. We don't want to see the technology of the central lab. People don't like to go to a central lab to get, particularly when you're not the engineer at the central lab. You want to be next to the technology to be able to use it every day, and by having lower pricing points, that happens. And for me, that is the most exciting part, Jim, is when we see that the vision that we launched Exact Metal, which is to make the technology more affordable so that more and more people can afford it, is what makes Exact Metal, makes me successful, makes me smile, makes our whole team proud of what we're doing. The picture of you at Virginia Commonwealth University installing a 3D printer, and that happening around the world, the picture of a company like using the technology to support their tooling operation because they can now afford the technology, can bring productivity and successful into their job. That's, for me, the exciting part. To me, there's so many applications that I can pick, but to see the US Army deploying the technology increasingly more and more and more next to the operator so that they can get access to this technology and do their job and be successful, that's what makes me excited.
Thank you. Yeah, I appreciate that take on the question. Yeah, it's not just about applications. It's about like being able to do it in the first place and simply being to have people start and access this technology and see what they can do with it and how they can grow it. That's extremely exciting.
As we're going in order. So for me, one of the interesting things about the DED in general and Meltio in specific is that, you know, we don't have to start with a clean powder bed or a clean sheet of paper, if you will. We can start with a substrate that is existing. And so that enables different applications. And one of the key applications is repair. So, you know, for a plant engineering team, you know, that's trying to keep their machinery up and running and they have some wear items, you know, brake presses or mandrels for sheet metal forming, what grippers, you know, they can actually just take the old part, bring it in, figure out the wear area, do some additive, and then do some subtractive to bring it back to the original specification. And in many cases, you know, they're not throwing away an expensive tool, and they're shortening their lead time and kind of controlling their own destiny, as Jonah talked about earlier. And so those are kind of unique applications to the DED style printing, and you know, one that kind of warms my heart right now and is kind of geopolitically relevant today is we actually have U.S. Navy machine destroyers in the peninsula driving or floating around with our technology, where they're shortening their supply chain and building new parts on the fly on these destroyers, you know, while they're, you know, trying to protect shipping lanes, you know, from what's going on in the Middle East right now. So, you know, that's kind of a supply chain shortening story.
Yeah, extremely interesting. And another cool example of the technology growing in its use and adoption and being brought into new areas. It's extremely cool.
Yeah, so I'll speak generally at first about applications that are, you know, real world applications and success stories for the, you know, the technologies. But I encourage, you know, anyone on the call, please visit Desktop Metal's website. There are a lot of great case studies that you can dive into and read about that are amazing success stories. But I think generally speaking, you know, what Michael and Juan are talking about is true. You want to attack problems in which you can't solve the problem any other way except through additive. So if you've got very complicated geometry that you need to create that you can't create with other manufacturing processes, focus on that. The high tolerance, highly precision geometry, that can be created as through a secondary effort. It's as simple as if you had a complicated manifold with all types of internal piping to bring your fluids, mix fluids and bring your fluids through a manifold. That's geometry that you really can't create any other way. So print that. And then the external geometry that it might interface with other parts of the assembly, you can always machine or touch up and create very high precision surfaces that way. That's the way to think about it. And then how precise do you want to create the surfaces? That's your, you know, you can design that for whichever process you're looking at. So at Desktop Metal, we have some amazing examples of like a, you know, of low volume production using the shop system, in which customers might set a shop system on the floor of a factory. And then as they need spare parts, they print them and very quickly kind of control their own supply chain. And then in higher volume, automotive applications where there's a lot of customization happening, where you want your own little custom, you know, shifter, or you want your custom emblem on your vehicle, or you have a custom bracket that's being produced. The shop system is being applied to those higher volume applications, again, that are tool free and that you can customize that way. But again, please you know, visit desktopmetal.com and you'll be able to see all these little great examples of where the technology is being applied.
Outstanding. Thank you. Well, gentlemen, the next section up is the customer Q&A, but I guess I just want to pause for a second and just acknowledge, I mean, if somebody was like a WWF fan and they came onto this webinar hoping for a battle, they are sorely upset. Everyone got along very well. And being extremely fair to one another and where technologies fit and where they don't. A point I'd like to make for the audience is, like, look, you don't have to start looking into metal additive when somebody says, hey, you know, we have some budget, let's get a machine. The time is when a problem comes up, like, I have this part, I can't get this part. This thing's a pain. What if I could make this a different way? Just looking around and saying, hey, there's got to be a better way. So if you guys have some parts like that, please send them our way. You see, we have these wonderful
people here who can help us understand where a part fits and where it doesn't. We'd love to help you identify some of the parameters by which metal additive could be successful or not, and at what time. So we'd love to encourage anybody who's watching this to, you know, send us some examples, some cases where maybe we can help and try to bring some idea of where metal fits in for you, metal 3D printing. So with that, Evan, please, I'll let you take over, and we'll take some Q&A from the audience.
Great, sure. So one question we had come in was a little while ago, when Juan Mario was talking about the powder used for exact metal, they were wondering what size the powder is.
Yeah, typically for laser powder bed, you're looking for particle sizes that are around 15 to 45 micron in range on the P5 to P95 level. So 15 to 45 will be the particle size that you're looking at.
Awesome. Okay. Next question is, on a scale of 1 being concept evaluation to 10 being successful deployment, how would you measure the technology readiness level for the technology you're providing?
Well, I'll give it a shot. Laser powder bed is definitely the most mature of all the technology in terms of its adoption in the marketplace. You see DD, you see binder jet systems coming in and developing nicely and being adopted nicely. But in terms of the number one adoption technology today is laser powder bed. And Michael said it correctly, a lot of it focused in aerospace and medical. The technology has been around for 30 years. It's well known. It's well deployed in terms of standards, and the standards continue to develop. We haven't talked a lot about that, but as the technology has continued to mature, the work that we're all doing on standard development will allow the technology to further be adopted. And that's very important as well. Michael, you're mute.
It sounds like this is someone from the DOD, you know, we actually participated in a competition over the last month or quarter, I guess, and the Army assigned us a readiness level of 7, if that helps.
Yep. So, you know, TRL is a very well-established scale. If we want to speak in TRL, it goes from 1 to 9. So 10 is, I'm not sure exactly what 10 is, but if you look at what the TRL level, how it defines the levels, your highest level, number 9, is if you've taken your technology through a complete mission. If it's gone through and completed a full mission in the field and in actual, the actual environment and then come out and succeeded, gone through the life of its product. And I think that all three of these technologies have accomplished that. There are systems out in the field with various customers that are succeeding in accomplishing their missions. So the TRL level that is possible with this technology is at the highest. It's a 9. These systems are ready and operational. However, TRL level is also unique to your own company. So if your company has not deployed this technology yet and you haven't run it through its missions, then it is going to be at a different TRL level for you. So that would be at a TRL level of, you know, call it a 7 or even an 8, in which you're aware of the technology, you've seen it in application, but not in your environment, and you've never run it in your own missions. So I encourage you to get any of these technologies up to TRL level 9 in your companies, because it's possible, it's being done elsewhere, and we can help you with the help of SimQuest and all of our companies. We can help you get there and show you how to be successful in any one of these technologies.
Yeah, I'll build up a little bit more on that. I think I'm very excited to see the work that Mel-Q and Desktop Metal are doing in both large part manufacturing and as well as in high volume additive manufacturing. It's just very exciting to see the technology start to mature in a way that allows more and more applications to be met. And I would agree with Yona that most of this technology, unless we start pushing a particular application that's never been done, this technology, we've probably done the application already someplace else. It's been mature, it's been proven. And it's at a very high level, TRL level in the military type of definition. The exciting part is that all these technologies are growing very, very fast in all industries. I think I read a report recently that expect all three of our technologies to grow in the 30 to 40% a year for the next many years. And I think that's just showing the readiness of the technology in terms of maturity level to go after not just niche applications, but now more and more increasing manufacturing applications.
Awesome. So in a similar vein, and this sort of may have just been touched on a bit. Also, I have a hunch that this is only supposed to go to 9 as well. So correct me if I'm wrong, but the same person followed up with, on a scale of 1 being proposed concept to 10 or maybe 9, being full production process qualified, how would you measure the manufacturing readiness level of the equipment? And if you feel that this was already touched on, we can move on.
I think you and I described it very, very well. It just depends on, we are doing this everywhere. We're producing manufacturing parts everywhere in all three of our cases. And just, I think it depends the particular customer where you are. That I will build up on that answer in that I see us as an industry further developing the standards, further developing the ease of adoption by allowing a manufacturer or a small company to be able to buy a machine and then say it meets to this standard and you can provide to these OEMs. That's developing. But in terms of producing parts and in manufacturing environments, we're doing every day in many, many industries.
All right. Anyone else?
I'd comment, and not trying to be controversial here, but I personally believe that the technology, the powder bed fusion with lasers that Juan is promoting and his company is based on, I think that's a little bit further along, certainly than the Meltio technology, and maybe even the binder jet or the material extrusion technology that Jonah, you know, just because it's been there so much longer. I mean, our company's only 3.5 years old, and I don't know the exact history, but binder jetting isn't all, you know, I don't think it's 30-year-old technology. So I think they got a little bit of an edge on readiness right now, in my opinion, but I could be wrong.
Yeah, so for sure what Michael's talking about is true, that if we were to look at all three of these processes, laser-based processes was commercialized in the early 2000s and really gained traction with some of the big aerospace companies and also medical spaces. And they took the laser-based technologies at the time and really, really matured them. But I feel like that brought them up, you know, in a maturity level faster than any of these other technologies that we're talking about. However, when you talk about manufacturing readiness level, that's very internal. It's an internal metric to your company. Are you ready? Have you qualified the manufacturing readiness of a type of process, manufacturing process? So if you brought in, sheet metal stamping into your company, if you've never qualified the sheet metal stamping process before, you'd be at a very low MRL level until you then studied it, understood the process control, published your long-term and short-term variability, and then and really understood how to design for it. So MRL is an internal metric, but I can tell you that for all three of these processes, there are companies who have studied and published and understand at a very, very high MRL level the process capability that you can achieve with this metal, with each of these additive manufacturing processes.
Fantastic. Okay, so I do want to point out we're a little over time. We do have about 4 more questions left over. So we'll go ahead and do those now. If anyone needs to sign off on the attendee side, there is a recording of this that will go out later. So maybe your question hasn't been asked yet, you can check in on that later. So next question we have is, What does your material roadmap look like? More specifically, can you share or elaborate on any materials that you're working on that are not in the marketplace yet?
Now, Michael actually said this nicely, and I think you said it too. We are focused on developing materials where we see there's a good volume of customers that can buy that. There's materials being developed today with laser powder bed that are very unique and very niche. And for us, it's hard to spend the energy to do that. You can do that with one of our assistants, and you can get your development done if the laser is the right solution for that. But for us, the focus has been in getting the technology. For us, the focus is not in material development. We are focused on getting the technology. There are several materials. They're all proven in laser powder bed. We are launching soon new materials, like I said, corrosion-resistant tool steel, but there are proven materials that are available. We are focused on bringing the technology to be more and more affordable in the marketplace so that more and more people can afford it. And we need to focus on that and not develop new materials that are not the core of the industry today.
I mentioned earlier with Meltio, steels are great for us now. Titanium is good. I will caveat that right now our process does not minimize the oxidation enough to qualify as medical grade 5 or grade 3. So we're working on technology that'll allow us to enter the implant business with grade 5 or 3 titanium. And then also expanding into aluminum and copper over the next year or so, probably less. No plans to go into ceramics because it's very different technology. Trying to get into some really hard materials like stellites and tungstens and carbides, but honestly not having great success right now. But that's probably the next frontier after the materials of aluminum and copper.
Yep, I would agree. And then, so for binder jetting at Desktop Metal, the bread and butter are stainless steels and super alloys. They produce great properties, very easy and reliable to print. That's your go-to. We would love to get into more reactive materials like aluminums and titaniums, but again, if you don't have to go there, you don't have to go there. So, we're really excited about some of the ceramics work as well. So reach out if you've got anything in ceramics.
Okay, next question. If I wanted to see your technology in person, where could I go?
Can I answer it?
Yeah, Jen, SimQuest.
You can come to SimQuest primarily at our Branchburg, New Jersey office. But in case you might happen to be a little further away than that, we have many happy reference customers and lighthouse customers that we can certainly connect you with to see the nearest running machine. But I do think, unfortunately, we should probably wrap up at this point. I want to be respectful of everyone's time. But I just want to thank you all for joining. The remaining questions, we'll be happy to send you those and make sure you get those. And if I can help you answer a specific person's question, we'll make sure you have the opportunity to do that. So again, thank you so much, everybody, and have a great day.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Thanks, everyone.
Great.
Thanks, Jim.
Thank you.